We've been talking for some time now on Sunday mornings about things like bad temper. And you all look so civilized and sophisticated that you probably don't even know what I'm talking about. So maybe take another example, resentment. You know, things like resentment. Or things like those little asides in conversation that you use to draw attention to one of your few virtues. And really what we've been seeing is we have a great tendency to look at those inward attitudes that are not quite right. We have a great tendency to look at them just as inexpedient little human traits that we should try to deal with someday. Of course, last Sunday we saw and studied a verse that certainly did not encourage us to do that. Now, maybe you'd look at that verse. It's Romans 8 and verse 7. Romans 8 and 7. And it's page 982. Romans 8 and 7. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Now, temper is a work of the flesh, you see. That's what God calls temper. Or resentment is a work of the flesh. Or boasting is a work of the flesh. And those works of the flesh come from the mind of the flesh. And of course, this verse is saying that the mind of the flesh is not just some little inexpedient trait that you should try to get rid of someday if you can, but the mind of the flesh is hostile to God. It is diametrically opposed to God. It is defiantly antagonistic to Him. And so the mind of the flesh is not just some little inexpedient trait. That is a misconception on our part. The mind of the flesh is a rebel against God. It doesn't submit to God's law. Indeed, it actually cannot. And so really, we saw last day, we need to take a different attitude towards it entirely. Oh, you can see it, really, and where it stems from and the source of it, if you take a thing like lying, which all of us know plenty about, I think. And just take the little white lie that we've talked about before. The little white lie that we tell to cover up the missed assignment. Now, it could be a missed appointment. But just that little white lie that we tell to cover up the missed assignment. Now, loved ones, God has another way completely. God's approach to that missed assignment is absolutely and utterly different to the white lie. And we often don't see that. God's way is an open confession of your failure. A blank, honest admission of your wrongdoing. And therefore, an honest opinion of you in the professor's mind. He really sees you as you are. But as a result of that, an absolute freedom from strain in the relationship, even though there is embarrassment, at least you are being honest with each other. And on top of that, a freedom from stuffing the old subconscious mind with all kinds of fear and guilt because you've really bluffed it out. So God's way is utterly different, you see. But of course, our way is not that at all. We really want to pretend that we aren't what we appear to be, careless about assignments. We want him to have a wrong impression of us. That's it, you know. We argue that, I'm not really as careless as that, so if he saw that I had missed that assignment, he would get a wrong impression of me. But loved ones, facts speak louder than words. And at that moment, you were careless. And it is more honest to let him see that you did forget the assignment. And really, that's God's way. God's way is for us to be honest about it, not to try to give a better impression of ourselves than is true. God's way is to open the relationship up. Okay, so he doesn't think you're perfect, but at least there's honesty between you. At least you're not trying to draw a veil across yourself and pretend you're better than you are. God's way is utterly different, you see. And of course, the person that you're following when you tell the white lie is God's enemy. You can see the power that produced the white lie in John 8 and 44. John 8 and 44. We continue to be stupid about this, you know, loved ones. We continue to think we're being pretty shrewd and clever, and it's really us that's producing the lie. It isn't, you know. It's really coming from the heart of the first rebel against God. And we're really aligning ourselves with him when we tell even a white lie. It's 932. You of your father, John 8 and 44, you are of your father the devil. Jesus is saying to the Pharisees, you are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and has nothing to do with the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks according to his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. And loved ones, a white lie is not just a white lie. It's an expression of a whole way of dealing with life's problems that is utterly different to God's. It's completely opposed to truth and honesty, and it's opposed to it because you have a feeling deep down, God can never pull me out of this one on his own. I really have to help him. I cannot see how he can deliver me from this. And really, loved ones, it's just utterly opposed. We keep on, of course, pretending that this kind of thinking is just endemic to human nature. This is just the kind of thing human beings do, and you can't possibly get rid of it. This is the way we're built. And we keep on bluffing ourselves that God is utterly opposed to this kind of thinking, but he's satisfied with destroying Jesus instead of destroying this kind of thinking in us. And so he's prepared to put up with us continuing to do what we cannot avoid doing. And that's the kind of mixed logic we go through. We keep on pretending to ourselves, well, this kind of behavior is endemic to us human beings. We can't be other than this. We can't possibly get rid of this little tendency of the mind of the flesh to go Satan's way. We just have to accept this. Even God accepts it. God is satisfied to destroy Jesus instead of destroy this in us. And that's why he allows us to continue to exist. So really, loved ones, we encourage each other to tolerate inward sin. We do. We just encourage each other to tolerate this. We kind of build each other up and say, oh yeah, now as long as God is prepared for us to regard him as our Father here on earth, then maybe we can just continue to like this. And, well, we know we really should have that mind of the flesh dealt with. We really know we should turn from that way of dealing in the world completely. We know that we should let this be actualized in Jesus' death. This death of Jesus should be allowed to destroy this in us. But, oh, well, I can't do it. So I'm going to go on and try to please God as best I can, and maybe as I'm trying to please him, somehow the Holy Spirit will cleanse me from this heart of darkness. Of course, loved ones, really, I mean, that's why Jesus died. In Jesus, God put this heart of darkness that we have inside each one of us, this sneaking kind of heart that always whispers, tell a lie, tell a lie, tell a lie. It's the easy way out. This sneaking heart of darkness that always says, you have a right to resent that person. Look what they did to you. That heart of darkness was what God destroyed in Jesus on Calvary. And really, God wants us to have that made real in us. But we keep on saying, oh, well, someday, someday. Meanwhile, I'll just get on and I'll try to please God and turn away from this negative stuff. Now, loved ones, it's that kind of thinking that drives Christians to the brink of nervous breakdown. Really it is. It's that kind of thinking. That kind of thinking that says, well, I know I should really leap by faith into Jesus' death and allow the Holy Spirit to cleanse my heart completely. But, well, I can't just do it yet. So meanwhile, I'm going to go and try to please God as well as I can. Loved ones, that drives you to the brink of nervous breakdown. And there's one reason for it. It's today's verse, if you look at it in Romans 8 and verse 8. Romans 8 and verse 8. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So you know, dear lovers, we trail this old self on our backs. And this mind of the flesh that always works out it's easier to lie than to tell the truth. We drag that along on our backs. And we say, well, we know we should dump it at the cross. We know we should die with Jesus and leap into him by faith. Well, I'll do it someday. But meanwhile, I'm going to try to please God as well as I can. And the Bible says, if you're in the flesh, you can't please God. You can't love him the way you're supposed to. You can't praise him the way you're supposed to. You can't thank him the way you're supposed to. Those who are in the flesh can't please God. You see, we make the mistake. We keep thinking, well, we know if we're in the flesh, we can't avoid bad temper. And we can't avoid being irritable at times. But we can't please God. Now, loved ones, you can't. That's what drives you crazy. Because you keep thinking, well, I'm not perfect. I'm not perfect. We always like to say that. I'm not perfect. Well, I mean, God isn't calling you to be perfect as he's perfect. He's calling you just to obedience. But we always say, oh, well, I'm not perfect. I know that. But I can go on and please God as well as possible. Now, loved ones, that's the killer. You can't. If you're in the flesh, you can't please God. You just can't do it. In other words, many of us understand Romans 6, but we don't really understand Romans 7. You remember we mentioned that a couple of Sundays ago. Many of us know the problem of Romans 6. Maybe you'd look at it. Romans 6 and verse 1. We see that problem plain enough. It's 981. Page 981. Romans 6 and 1. We see that problem. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? We see that. How can we possibly be delivered from losing our temper, from getting irritable, from being resentful? And we see that the only way is Romans 6 and 6. That God has destroyed the heart of that old mind of the flesh, that fleshly way of thinking that wants to lie. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the sinful body might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. So we see, yeah, that's the way to be freed from having to lose your temper. The killer is we're not prepared to take the step in verse 11 that actualizes that in our lives. You see that step in verse 11. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. And we're not quite ready to take that step. Instead of that, we decide, well, I'm not ready to take that step yet, but I'm going to try to please God. So then we come over to Romans 7, and we come up against that problem in verses 15 and 16. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want. I really want to please him, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. And we come into that problem, not now of avoiding bad temper and resentment, but how to obey God, how to please him. And now we find that there's something in us that doesn't want to please him. And we find that as far as pleasing God is concerned, we have, in verse 24, a body of death. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? And really, loved ones, that's it. As far as praising or glorifying or pleasing God, when we're in the flesh, we have a body of death. You cannot do it. You know, some of you say, well, how can I love God unless I really have allowed the Holy Spirit to fill me. Well, you really can't, you know. You'll love him, you'll kind of love him periodically, you know. You remember when Jesus said to Peter, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, you know that I love you, Lord. And Jesus said, feed my lambs. And then Jesus, as if he didn't hear right, asked him again, do you love me? And Peter said, yeah, I love you. And Jesus said, well, feed my lambs. And then, as if he didn't hear him, a third time he asked him, do you love me? Now, in the Greek, of course, the words are utterly different. There are two words used, agapao and phileo. And really, the narrative runs like this. Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I'm very fond of you. But Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I'm very fond of you. Peter, do you love me? And then Peter, you know that I love you, Lord. Now you see, you can be very fond of God. When you're in the flesh, you can be very fond of him. Grateful to him for all the things he's given us. Glad that he's our Father. But you can only love him with all your heart when you cease to be in the flesh. That's what the Bible means when it says you can't please God if you're in the flesh. In other words, instead of letting the old horse die on Calvary with Jesus, instead of leaping by faith into him and dying with him as far as the flesh is concerned, we tend to try to beat the old horse into producing the kind of performance that only an absolutely supernatural thoroughbred can produce. And that's really what we're involved in. We're trying to beat that old mind of the flesh into loving God. And you know the tricks we use. You know how we do it, loved ones, in prayer. We try to think, let me think of all the things God has given me. That'll stir love in my heart. Let me think of Jesus on Calvary. That'll stir love in my heart. I have to praise God. God, you're a good God. You're a good God. Well, that's not praising you. Well, I praise you, Lord. I don't feel a praise. And we try to womp ourselves up to please God. Loved ones, you can't do it in the flesh. Those who are in the flesh can't please God. What should we do then? We should leap by faith into our death with Jesus to the world of the flesh. That's what we should do. You should leap by faith into your death with Jesus on the cross and accept by faith that God has destroyed that old fleshly mind that constantly wants to lie and resent and lose its temper and wants anything but God. You should accept by faith that that has been crucified with Jesus and then submit to the Holy Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to deliver you. That's the only way, really. Now, why is it the case that you have to move out of the world of the flesh into the world of the Spirit to do this? What is it to be in the flesh? If those who are in the flesh cannot please God, what does it mean to be in the flesh? Does it mean that you're in a human body? Well, it doesn't mean that, you know. It doesn't mean that you're literally in a human body as opposed to being a disembodied spirit. Some of us interpret in the flesh, oh, it means we're here on earth instead of being in heaven. Oh, it means we're physical instead of being spiritual. Loved ones, in the flesh means that you depend on what you see and touch and hear and smell and taste for the fulfillment of all your needs. It means you live as if your physical body and your physical environment are the only sources of supply for your own personal needs. That's what it means to live in the flesh. It means another thing too. It means that when you live in the flesh, you want everything to go the way you want. You want your needs fulfilled the way you want them fulfilled, when you want them fulfilled. That's what it means to live in the flesh. Now, when Jesus died, in the tomb, none of the sunlight could get through to him. He couldn't pick apples and eat them. He couldn't use water to wash his body. Whatever peace he had in that tomb, he had to receive it from God alone. Now, when we leap into Jesus' death from the cross, we agree to be in the same situation. We agree to be cut off from depending on physical environment and physical body for the supply of our needs. When Jesus was in the tomb during those 3 days, nobody could pay attention to him at all. He was just ignored. When we leap into Jesus' death on the cross, we agree no longer ever to demand that people give us respect, give us attention, listen to us. That's what leaping into Jesus by faith means. And that, loved ones, is the only spaceship that is leaving Earth and going to the moon. That's the only spaceship that will carry you from the world of the flesh into the world of the spirit. You can't get out of living in the flesh any other way but leaping into Jesus' death by faith. Maybe it helps, you know, to take some plain examples, though really you can think of your own. You know. You come home from a hard day. You've just plowed through the snow. You're dead beat, dead tired. You've battled your colleagues. You've battled the professors. You've battled everybody. And you just fall through the door. And you immediately think, oh, just a hot bath, sauna, drink, a good meal, a newspaper, TV program, an orderly room. That's all I want. All I want. And I'll be okay. That's living in the flesh. Because you know that the works of the flesh stem from that. Because she hasn't the meal ready. But that's the vital thing you need for peace and relaxation. You need a good meal. She hasn't the meal ready. And the old irritability comes right out. A hot bath. And the 7-year-old son is in the bathroom. Your TV program? She wants to watch The Galloping Gourmet. Do you see it all lines up, loved ones? And we keep on protesting, oh, but that I have a right to receive, that will bring me peace, that will bring me relaxation. But loved ones, every time you're dependent on the things you see and touch and smell, everything you perceive with your 5 senses, every time you're dependent on the physical body or the physical environment, you open yourself immediately to the works of the flesh just spewing out from you. The irritability, the impatience, the anger when the newspaper isn't right, the disgust and discontent when the room is disorderly. All of that flows from depending on your physical environment and your physical body for peace and relaxation. That's living in the flesh. God, of course, has an absolutely different way. He doesn't believe that's your problem at all when you come home after battling the colleagues and the professors and plowing through the snow. His way is stated in John 14 and 7, of course, if you look at it. John 14 and 7. From time to time, I look up a different Bible, one that I write myself. Dear ones, will you give me my peace I give unto you? John 14 and 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. And we say, oh, be practical. The peace I need is the peace that comes through my body. My body's worn and strained. If I had a sauna, I'd feel so relaxed. That's the peace I need. That spiritual peace, that can't bring quietness to my mind and peace to my body. Loved ones, that's what living in the flesh is. It's disagreeing with God utterly and completely about what you need. And it's looking to the wrong source for the supply of your needs. And the truth actually is, if you would once die to that ridiculous and stupid dependence on those physical things to bring you peace, and would instead commit yourself to beginning to look up to Jesus and ask him to make that real to you, he would make it real to you. And believe it or not, you would have peace and quietness in your mind. And your body would relax, you know. Your body actually would relax. And you would begin to have freedom from strain if you would do that. But you see, there's another thing that living in the flesh means. You see the whole emphasis. Poor me. Here I am after plowing through the snow and battling those brutes in the office. And here I am home and all I want, poor little me, all I want is my TV program and my newspaper and slippers and a bath. That's not much to ask. I. The reason why a person in the flesh can't please God is that they don't want to please God. They're so busy pleasing themselves. They're so wrapped up pleasing themselves. They judge everything by how it affects them. A person who is in the flesh refers everything to themselves. They're concerned first and foremost about whether they're pleased or not. They haven't time to please God. A person in the spirit pleases himself by pleasing God, but a person in the flesh only wants to please himself. Now, loved ones, that's the situation we're in when we're in the flesh. And a person in the flesh cannot please God. And what we are doing, of course, is we're trying to hold on to a fleshly way of thinking and at the same time work in a little pleasing God. And you can't. The mind of the flesh is the Greek word phronema. And it actually doesn't mean so much the mind of the flesh as the thinking of the flesh, the way a person in the flesh thinks. And loved ones, do you see that you can't think that way, the way people in the flesh think, and still please God? You can't do it. Because you're looking to the wrong source for your needs and you're determined to please the wrong person at heart. So the motive is wrong and the power is wrong. And you cannot please God. That's why so many of us walk such defeated lives. There's only one way, you know. Die with Jesus. Really? In the tomb with him. Leap by faith into Jesus' death. See what it involves for you. See what being in a tomb would involve for you. And then decide whether you're ready for that. And then don't hang around looking into the tomb, because that's one way to put yourself off. Leap by faith into Jesus. Say, Lord, as far as I'm concerned, from this moment on, I'm going to live my life looking to you for these things. I'm tired being a sponge, sucking up from my relatives, from my wife, from my husband, from my friends, from my roommates, all that I think I need. Lord, I'm dying with Jesus to that. I commit myself now to his death, and I believe that you destroyed me with him. And now, Holy Spirit, I look to you for all my needs. And loved ones, you'll begin to find that the power of the Holy Spirit lifts you onto a new level. Now, do you see that you can only stand on the edge of a swimming pool so long? There comes a time when you have to plunge in and trust the water to hold you up. And if you keep standing on the edge of the swimming pool and looking at the water and saying, will that Holy Spirit hold me up? You'll never find out. You're wise to look at the length of the pool and to look at the depth of the water, but after you've looked at that, there comes a time when you leap by faith into Jesus' death. And really, that's the only way to come out of the flesh. You know? And unless you do it, I think you're going to find continual frustration in pleasing God. And you're going to find it a terrible burden to keep trying to please Him. Whereas if you leap into Jesus by faith, the Holy Spirit will lift you into a new environment, and you'll find that you cannot help pleasing God. So would you think about it, loved ones? And especially I'd love you to see where you're trying to substitute willpower for leaping by faith into Jesus. You know, you're trying to pick at the problem instead of change the whole way of thinking. A person who feels they have to depend on the hot bath for freedom from strain is at the mercy of the little fellow who is playing with the boats in his bath, and therefore is at the mercy of his own irritability and impatience when he finds he can't get what he wants. The person who depends on Jesus for peace is never going to be let down. Jesus is never too busy looking after somebody else to give you the spirit of peace. And so really it's possible to live in continual peace and continual quietness. So I really do pray, you know, that some of you are beginning to move into some of these things on this week, you know, check it out this week, especially if we get a few more inches of snow. You know. Check it out this week and look at yourself. You know, carry it over into that 5 o'clock time when you get home and say, am I living in the flesh here or am I living in the spirit? And you'll begin to see that if you lift off completely and begin to live in the spirit, it is amazingly easy to obey God. Dear Father, we've known these times when we come home at night from that day. Even when it's been a good day, we do find ourselves taking the attitude, well, we're home and now we can have everything the way we want it. We do admit, Father, there's something in us that says we have a right to have it the way we want it. That's why you have a home, so that you can do what you want when you want. Then, Father, we're surprised when we seem to produce more bitterness and irritability to the loved ones that we share our home with than we ever produced through the day at work. And we can see, our Father, it's because of the level of our expectations. We see that it's because we're expecting from them what we can only receive from you. Oh, Father, we see that we live in the flesh so much of our time. Lord Jesus, we've heard your word so often, peace I give unto you. But Lord, we just never realized that your peace could bring us real quietness at the end of the day. We've never realized that your peace could do what a martini could not do, or what a sauna could not do. Lord Jesus, we see that you look to God alone when you were in the tomb, and that you want us to join you there, because that's where indeed we were placed. We thank you, Father. We thank you that you did crucify us with Jesus. We thank you that you can raise us up into resurrection life if we simply leap by faith. Father, I would pray that some of my brothers and sisters would leap by faith into Jesus' death this week and would enter into the life you have for us all, for your glory. Amen.